Romans 5, 12 through 21. There are places in Romans that are easy. There are places in Romans that are rich. They're easy, but there's a lot there. There are places in Romans that are complicated. And there's Romans 5, 12 through 21. Kind of is all three. It's complicated. It's rich. But it's also somewhat simple, but it's difficult sometimes when it's simple. Einstein had a lot of good sayings. One of Einstein's sayings that I've always liked is he said, we should make things as simple as possible, but not simpler than they are. To make things as simple as possible, but not any simpler than they actually already are. And the point is, sometimes in the interest of simplicity, in the interest of understandability, we gloss over things that are important and necessary. And it would be very easy for us to do that with the passage tonight. And so what I want to do, instead of trying to do some kind of elaborate outline with application that stems from that, I just want to walk us through these verses. And we're going to look at three main key areas to kind of guide our study. That's the point of your outline tonight, is these three points. There will be some application as part of it, but we're really going to just tie ourselves as much to the text tonight so that we get a real feel for what's going on there. So let's read Romans 5, 12 through 21. Therefore, just as sin came into the world through one man, and death through sin, and so death spread to all men because all sin, for sin indeed was in the world before the law was given, but sin is not counted where there is no law, yet death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over those whose sinning was not like the transgression of Adam, who was a type of the one who was to come. But the free gift is not like the trespass. For if many died through one man's trespass, much more have the grace of God and the free gift by the grace of that one man, Jesus Christ, abounded for many. And the free gift is not like the result of that one man's sin. For the judgment following one trespass brought condemnation, but the free gift following many trespasses brought justification. For if because of one man's trespass death reigned through that one man, much more will those who receive the abundance of grace and the free gift of righteousness reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ. Therefore, as one trespass led to condemnation for all men, so one act of righteousness leads to justification and life for all men. For as by the one man's disobedience the many were made sinners, so by the one man's obedience the many will be made righteous. Now the law came in to increase the trespass, but where sin increased, grace increased more. So that as sin reigned in death, grace also might reign through righteousness, leading to eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. So, we want to make this as simple as possible, but not overly simplistic. We want to see what Paul's getting at here. And we have to put ourselves in the mindset of Paul and those first Christians hearing, reading, studying this letter. They are operating from a worldview, from a framework that is very different from the worldview and framework in which we operate. And so it's easy for us sometimes to misconstrue what is being said and to jump to some conclusions. And there's some places in here where people have made some really bad interpretive conclusions because they read things and they forget that Paul is making an argument. He's not trying to be very precise when he's trying to make his argument. He's being precise, but not in the sense of the precision that sometimes we expect from language. And so we want to be very careful about that. So let's look tonight at Romans 5, 12 to 21. The first thing we see there is death through Adam. Death through Adam. Therefore, he says there in verse 12, just as sin came into the world through one man, and death through sin, and so death spread to all men because all sin. Sin came into the world through the sin of Adam. Adam's disobedience to God. Going all the way back to Genesis 3. Genesis 2, you have the story where God forms Adam and Eve, and puts them in the garden to tend and to till it, and he tells them they can have any tree, any fruit of any tree in the garden but one. And then Genesis 3, the serpent connives and tells Eve to take of the fruit, and she does, and Adam does as well. Through that act of disobedience, through disobeying God, sin and brokenness and death come into the world. It is that act of disobedience that begins the process of our own sinfulness. Some argue that that act of sin is actually inherited from Adam to all people. I don't think that's what Paul's arguing. I think Paul is saying that that began the process of all people ultimately sinning. That all people would make the conscious choice to sin. As a result, the consequence of sin is death. So Adam sinned, and when Adam sinned, death came into the world. All people then sinned because all people become sinners because they choose to sin. As a result, death comes to all people. People make the conscious, willful choice to sin. You don't believe me? Just look at children. You tell a child not to do something, what do? They do it. Why do they do that? It's their nature to do that. The nature, the inclination to sin, is the result of Adam's sinfulness. It has been passed to all people, that willful desire to sin. Each person, therefore, sins. A theological term that you will sometimes hear is Adam will be referred to as our federal head. To define what that means so that you don't get complicated, think of it in terms of government. We have a federal form of government. We don't live in a democracy. We live in a republic. A federal republic, which means when we vote for representatives who will represent us in making the decisions that affect us. We don't make the decisions in the government. Our representatives make decisions for us. In the same sense, while each and every one of us individually choose to sin, Adam, as our federal head, becomes the representative for the fact that all of us sin. In a sense, Adam's sin opened up the Pandora's box of sin, unleashed sin upon the world, and all people have subsequently followed in that very same path. That's why Adam is significant here. And as a play on words, in Hebrew, the word Adam is the word for mankind, for man, as in people. So Adam is not just a single person, though he is a single person. He's representative of all people everywhere. Each person, because of that, is individually responsible for his or her own actions. Because you and I, though we inherit sin nature, though we are a part of Adam's race of sinners, every single one of us is individually responsible for the choices that we make. Now, we are free to choose what our nature inclines us to choose. Explain what I mean by that. Okay? If I had complete and total freedom, I could go out and fly. But I can't. So does that limit my freedom? No. I'm free to do what my nature allows me to do. My nature is I don't have wings. I'm too heavy to fly. I'm too heavy to jump real high. As a result, flying is not something I am free to do. So we are free to do what our nature is inclined to do. We get a sin nature from Adam, so what are we free to do? Sin. And as a result, what do? We sin. So we are therefore responsible for that. We can't just blame Adam and say it's all his fault. No, we are just as responsible. How many of you, when you were younger and did some things that you probably shouldn't have done, maybe went out with some friends that got into some trouble and you were part of that, and your parents found out, you tried to blame your friends and say it was their fault, what did your mom or daddy say? Well, you went with them, didn't you?
That's right.
You know, when we stand before God, we can't say, but God, I wanted to be a good person. I didn't want to sin. It's Adam's fault. It doesn't work that way. Instead, Adam becomes representative of all of us. That's why Ezekiel says in Ezekiel 18:3, the soul who sins shall die. The soul who sins, us. As a result of our sin, we shall die. The Son shall not suffer for the iniquity of the Father, nor the Father suffer for the iniquity of the Son. The righteousness of the righteous shall be upon himself, and the wickedness of the wicked shall be upon himself. See, the danger of trying to blame other people, trying to excuse our behavior by blaming other people, is it becomes a way for us to declare ourselves innocent by blaming our wrong on somebody else. Remember what happens in Genesis 3 when God comes in the garden and he confronts Adam and Eve? What they do? Who does Eve blame? The serpent. Who does Adam blame? Look, he blames God. I believe you. Look at it. He says, the serpent deceived me and I ate the fruit. Adam says, the woman you gave me, God. It's her fault and it's your fault for giving her to me. I don't think that holds up real well. Okay? The danger of that is we try to excuse our own wrongdoing. We're willing to admit that we made a mistake a lot of times, but we're ultimately not responsible in our own minds for that mistake. You ever met somebody? You know, I use the example of speeding a lot because it's something that happens to a lot of us. Have you ever known somebody, maybe you've done this too, you get pulled over for speeding, and you say, well, I was just keeping up with the flow of traffic. Okay? Now, I've learned that doesn't fly so well around here because there's just not a lot of traffic on the roads. Now, you could say, see how far behind I am? I'm just trying to catch up. That doesn't work. See, the reason we know that we're ultimately responsible, we all the time will blame other people, blame our environment, blame our upbringing, blame other people, whatever, is if we think about it, if that was what was the cause of our problems, then a change of environment, a change of relationship, whatever, would fix our problem, and it doesn't. I remember counseling a couple that didn't need to get married, and they had a lot of issues, a lot of struggles. They just couldn't get along. They really didn't need to be a couple. And the first, it wasn't Billy and Joanne, so I know there are other guys. It wasn't them.
I am sure.
I'll be in my office tomorrow trying to talk. But the first question I always ask any couple is, why do you want to get married? And a lot of times they say, well, we love each other or what, you know, what have you. This couple said, well, we just figure we fight and we argue all the time. We figure if we get married, that's going to fix our problems because then we won't fight so much. And I'm thinking, you know, if you don't live in the same house and you fight so much, wait till you share a bathroom. And a tiny closet, or 19 tiny closets. As we have. But the point is that, you know, if it was somebody else's fault, if it was not our responsibility, then a change of environment, a change of scenery, whatever, would change our behavior, and it doesn't. So that shows us the source of our problem is not external, but internal. So we don't even blame each other. It's our responsibility. Death came through Adam, and ultimately we bear responsibility for it. Even though Adam started it, we bear responsibility for it. And because of that, we see, and it's a little complicated, what Paul says there in verses 13 and following. It says, for sin indeed was in the world before the law was given, which that's a historical statement. Sin was in the world, started with Adam. The law is not given until Moses. So you've got many, 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 many years where sin's in the world, but there's no law. And Paul's already said that the law was given to make us aware of sin. So even if you don't know something is wrong, how can it be a problem? You know, ignorance is not always bliss in this regard. Because then he says, and this is where people sometimes get confused, but sin is not counted where there is no law. Some people take that to say that the absence of law gives an excuse for sin. And it's not what he's saying. Okay? Here's an example to kind of show that. Let's say, for instance, that you decide you're going to go to Walmart tomorrow. And you pull into the Walmart parking lot, and you get to the very front spaces, and there's no sign designated as handicap, and there's no painting on the ground designating as handicap. But you park there. Okay? There's nothing telling you can't park there. Okay? It's not handicapped. But let's say that next week you go and all the spots around there, a little further down, are handicapped, but that one, for whatever reason. You can park there because it's not marked as handicapped. Then you go the next week, and that one is marked as handicapped. And you park there, and you don't have a handicap placard. You park there two times before. You park there a third time, you get a ticket. And you go to the judge and say, well, I parked there two times before, and I didn't get a ticket. What's the problem? And the judge says, it was always handicapped. We shouldn't have it marked as handicapped. Do you have an excuse? Not really. You just didn't know. The law was existing. The law was there. The law said, this is the way it is. You just didn't know about the law. It doesn't mean that the law somehow creates the sin. It just makes it clear. See, to say that sin was not counted when there is no law does not mean that there was no reason for people to be held accountable. It simply means that when they're held accountable, they may not be aware of it because they don't have law. It doesn't mean they're not accountable for it. It just means that they're not aware of it at the time. That's why we need the gift of the law so that we know. If you don't get a vote in this, you know, God giving the law to show us what sin is an act of God's grace. He didn't have to do that. And we would still be just as guilty before God even without the law.
Could that mean that if we don't carry the law to others that are ignorant of the law, that they're not going to be judged as guilty?
No. And the reason is because, going back to Romans 1, Paul says the invisible qualities of God, His eternal power and divine nature, are plain to all, therefore they are without excuse.
Ignorance is no excuse.
Ignorance is no excuse. It's one of those situations where, I give another example with the law. South Carolina recently changed child safety seat laws. Okay? And so the laws are different. And it went on the news and the papers, everything, you know, this is the new law, so that you know. Just because you don't know that the laws have changed doesn't mean if you get pulled over and your child's in the wrong kind of seat, they won't give you a ticket. The law is the law. Regardless, God's law wasn't created at Moses. God's law existed before Moses. God's law existed from creation. And as a result, we are without excuse. God just graciously gave us the law so that we would know where we fall short. Ignorance is not bliss when it comes to this. If anything, ignorance is a worse state because you don't have any way of knowing. And as a result, you are guilty in an ignorant state. And so the sin issue is still there. There is because death is still there. And one way to look at it is if it was all about having the law to prove what sin is, then people without the law would never die. I mean, just using that logic of what Paul's saying is sin came through Adam and then therefore death. As a result, all people sin, therefore all people die. That's the argument. The law is kind of unnecessary to his argument. He's trying to say at this point, why do we have the law then? Well, we have the law so that we know what sin is. Without the law, we don't know. doesn't mean we don't sin. We should know we sin. We still sin because we violated God's law. Does that make sense? Better sense there? And this is why I said this. We've got to make it as simple as we can, but not simpler than it really is. And this is why I said this is not a difficult passage, but it can be a little complicated.
Why did they that before Moses' time that God just expected people to use common sense on how to treat other people, and it didn't always work?
I mean, you could say that, you know, and Jesus himself said the law gets summed up by love God, love people. That sums up the law. Love God, love people. Man, that's kind of common sense, in a sense. But because of our sin nature, we are blinded to that truth. We're blinded to that reality that we even do that. And it becomes impossible for us to do that. And so that's what we've got to remember. Paul's making the argument. He's building, every week we look at something, he's building this argument that we are incapable of saving ourselves. And that's why he says there in verse 14, yet death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over those whose sinning was not like the transgression of Adam. He says Adam then was a type of the one who was to come. And I'm not going to get into this just because it would take way more time and it's not something that I particularly understand really clearly, but it's there. There is a term in biblical interpretation called typology. And it's very prevalent in theological circles to talk about typology, where someone in the Old Testament particularly represents elements, characteristics that are then personified perfectly in Jesus. There's typology where you have a type, and then you have someone that are like the anti-type and that kind of thing. A good example would be David. David is a type of Jesus, type of Christ. David's not Jesus. David is not the Messiah. He falls short, but there are things that David does in his life, that God does through David, that can point us to Jesus. David and Goliath is a good example of that. In the story of David and Goliath, we are not David. We are the Israelites, scared to death to stand up to Goliath. Goliath is not our problems. Goliath is the things which are opposed to God. We can't stand up to that in our own strength, so we need someone to stand in place of us as a substitute to deal with what we can't deal with. That's what David does. As a result, David then becomes representative of what Jesus will then do on the cross in being our substitute and our sacrifice for what we couldn't do for ourselves. That's typology. That's you know, kind of how that works. Abraham and Isaac is another example of typology. Isaac being sacrificed, and Abraham and Isaac are going, and Isaac says, you know, where's the lamb? And Abraham says, God will himself provide the lamb. Well, Abraham knows what he thinks, but God knows more of what he thinks, and that's a typological argument. Adam becomes then a type, put in the sense of an anti-type. What Adam did for all of humanity in the negative, in sinning and disobeying and leading to death and destruction, what Adam did in the negative, Jesus did for humanity in the positive. So you have Adam and you have Jesus. You have the first Adam, you have the second Adam. Okay, in Jesus. So that brings to the second point, their life through Jesus. Have death through Adam, have life through Jesus. The question then, how did Jesus undo what Adam did? And we see there, verse 15, the free gift is not like a trespass. For if many died through the one man's trespass, much more have the grace of God and the free gift by the grace of that one man, Jesus Christ, abounded for many. And the free gift is not like the result of that one man's sin, but the judgment following one trespass brought condemnation, but the free gift following many trespasses brought justification. See, just as Adam's disobedience brought death, Jesus' obedience, perfect obedience, unto death, brings life. You see the parallel. But Paul is making an argument they are not exactly parallel. In fact, he makes the argument that what Jesus did was so much better than what Adam did. Now, here's another area where people can misconstrue and misinterpret and get in the weeds if they're not careful. Verse 17. For if, because of one man's trespass, death reigned through that one man, much more will those who receive the abundance of grace and the free gift of righteousness reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ. Therefore, as one trespass led to condemnation for all men, so one act of righteousness leads to justification and life for all men. Some people read that as a justification for universalism. Universalism is the belief that all people go to heaven regardless. And they'll make the argument that Jesus undid what Adam did. And if through Adam all people sin, then through Jesus all people have life. That would be what Paul is saying if that's the only sentence Paul ever wrote. You have to interpret Scripture with Scripture, and that's not what Paul's saying. Paul's making a literary statement that what Jesus did was actually better than what Adam did. In that while Adam's one sin, theoretically one sin, brought death to all mankind, Jesus' one act of righteousness, which is more than one act, brought life from death. Now, the point there is not to see there that they're equivalent opposites, but that Jesus did more than Adam could ever do. Here's one way to look at it, hypothetically speaking. This is not a perfect argument, and I don't want to get angry calls and letters over my theological issues. This is just a hypothetical argument, so don't think I'm making a definitive statement here. But here is the argument that I think would help us here. If Adam had obeyed perfectly, if Adam had never sinned, okay, and therefore sin had not entered the world, Adam's obedience would only have been sufficient for Adam. You follow that, right? That's what it's happening. If Adam had never sinned, if Adam had been perfectly obedient, Adam's obedience would have only been sufficient for Adam. Because here's why. If Adam had been perfect, one of Adam's kids could have blown it. That's hypothetical, but you can get the picture. Jesus was able, through his perfect obedience, to bring about salvation for all who would believe. So just as Adam, even if Adam had been perfectly obedient, that would have only been good for him. Jesus' perfect obedience wasn't just good for him, it was good for all people. It was good for everyone. That's the tough thing to get our minds around. The free gift of Jesus was justification. It was grace that he gives. It was the imputed righteousness of Jesus to us for each and every day. That's what Paul was able to say in Galatians 2:20-21. I have been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not nullify the grace of God, for if righteousness were through the law, then Christ died for no purpose. So he's making the argument there as he continues in Galatians to say that, it's Christ living through me because Christ died for me. And his death was sufficient for not just me, but for all who believe. So the death came through Adam, life then comes through Jesus Christ. And then the third thing that we see here is amazing grace. Verses 19 following, for as by the one man's disobedience the many were made sinners, so by the one man's obedience, the many were made righteous. Now the law came in to increase the trespass. But where sin increased, grace abounded all the more. so that as sin reigned in death, grace also might reign through righteousness leading to eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. We use the phrase amazing grace, and the question we have to ask is, what's so amazing about grace? What is it about grace that is so incredibly amazing? Thomas Watson said that till sin be bitter, Christ will not be sweet. The idea being that where sin increases, grace increases all the more. It's not that we go out and sin so that we can be more forgiven and know God's forgiveness better because we went out and sinned more. It's as we recognize the presence of sin in our lives, we become more and more aware of our need for grace. See, that's the thing, you know, as you get closer and closer to God, you see more and more how you fall short. And as you see how you fall short, you see more and more how you need grace. The hope should be, as we grow in our Christian faith, we become more cognizant and more aware of the fact that we are not perfect. We don't have it all together. And that instead we need grace every day of our life. The law shows us our sin, but we can do nothing about it because we have the law. The law just makes us aware of it. It doesn't fix our problem. Only God's grace can do that. So the more we are aware of our sinfulness, we only have two options: guilt or grace. Guilt is when we feel the weight, the burden of our sin, and we try to deal with it in our own strength. When you feel guilty for what you did, so you try to fix it. We do it by, greater effort. I'm just going to try harder next time. You know, how many of you have ever gone on a diet? You say, no more chocolate cake, and somebody makes chocolate cake, and you eat chocolate cake, and then you beat yourself up, and you say, next time I'm going to say no to chocolate cake. And the next time they make double chocolate cake. And just trying harder is not enough. Sometimes we try restitution. Well, I'll make it up next time. You know, I ate that piece of chocolate cake, I'll run 2 extra miles tomorrow. To deal with our guilt, we try to assuage our guilt that way. One that we're really bad about is self-justification. Well, we say stuff like, well, the real reason I did this was... insert excuse. That's guilt. It doesn't work. Speaking from experience, it doesn't work. The more guilt you feel, the worse you are. There are a lot of people out there who walk around burdened and weighed down with tremendous, incredible weights of guilt because they think they somehow have to make it up to God for all the stuff they've done wrong. They spend the rest of their lives, they spend the rest of their walk with God, trying somehow to repay God. If we couldn't pay Him to begin with, we can't repay Him once we get it. So that's the problem with guilt. Grace is the full and free awareness of God's love invading our lives and encountering our weaknesses. To know, and this is what makes grace so amazing, to know He is enough. It's not that you give 1% and He gives 99%. It's that you give 0 and He gives 100 and that's enough. It's not that you give a little and He gives the rest. It's He does all of it. See, sin is an ever-present struggle in our lives. It's true. We wrestle with it every single day. Where sin increases, grace abounds all the more. Grace will always be greater than the sin that you and I deal with. We have two choices. We can either carry guilt, or we can embrace grace. We can either live a life that is bound up and, you know, where we're so uptight because of the guilt we carry that we're about to pop, or we can just stop and just say for a minute, you know what? God really does love me as much as the Bible says He does. And while there is absolutely nothing that I bring to the table, nothing that earns God's favor, God loves me. And let that totally transform your heart. On your table, there are a song sheet. Y'all probably know the song, at least I hope you do. We've sung it before. Grace Greater Than Ourselves. Work lower tonight, summer. We go on vacation. Y'all sang Sunday, and it sounded pretty. Real pretty. So tonight, I want us to close by singing this.
But it's not a bench. So
we can sing it a cappella. I can give a chord.
Give us a chord.
I'll give the chord, Sue. You keep us on key. And we can sing the first, second, and last verse. Keep the third verse for your own personal study and devotional time. Okay? Let me get a chord. I expect four-part harmony.
Okay.
Greater than all of our sin. In Jesus' name we pray.